everybody, it's Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com, and today we're going to be reshaping the garden. Now you might think, what in the world is that? Well, spring is gone. All the spring bulbs are done. The lilacs are done. Summer plants are coming into their own now. And once things have been in your yard for years and years, you realize that some of them just need to go because we've planted other things. And the ones that you planted in the beginning when there was nothing there have now overgrown their stay. So we are going to be taking out this fleece plant. We have many more. In fact, we have one right there next to it. So while we will miss it, it's a nice background, we don't need it anymore because we have other plants around it that we would like to see. So I am going to be taking it down.
And you thought Lynn was dangerous with her garden knife.
This isn't mine, though. It's yours.
Well, I know, but you stole it.
Let me see how I can do with it. I don't want to whack my...
Let me get out of the way here of your swinging arm.
Okay. Watch where you're stepping. It just reminds me of Romancing the Stone. That's it.
That's what she did. She was holding the plant. Oh, come on. Put some muscle in there.
This is more like for song. Didn't she say, oh my goodness, what happened to the Doobie Brothers?
Have you been in the garden that long? Call you Lenny Bobbitts.
What would she say, mister?
Oh no, Mr. Bill. It's either that or you're gonna have to bring out the root assassin.
Yep. Didn't take me long at all. Off to the recycling center again. Wow, look at that roof. That is amazing.
That's your giant fleece plant.
This is my root assassin shovel.
Yeah, what's nice about that is these teeth all along the serrated edge along the whole shovel. It goes in beautifully. You can actually hear all the roots.
Cutting. Yep.
So, just a few more.
Yep, I'd say this was really happy where we had it. And it would only get happier.
Those are some amazing roots.
Yes, they are. Well, it's called a polymorphous for a reason. It is down dead to the ground in the summer, or excuse me, in the winter, and within 2 months it is 6 feet tall. It's amazing.
Now what are you gonna do with this?
Recycling center.
You're not gonna chop them and keep them, huh?
No, I have another one we took out that I have roots from, so.
Okay.
I have plenty. Just a reminder that if you have pipes and wires and cable running to your house, call Digger's Hotline before you dig so you know where those are. Give them a 3 days heads up. This we know is a gas line that runs from the street directly to the house. So we have put our own stake in here now that we know where it is. Every year the frost pushes it up, so every year we push it down a little bit so we know where it is. And that way we're safe. Now that we have the fleece plant gone, you can see the hole where it used to be. We'll be amending the soil and then we'll be moving some other plants that we have that need more space. And this will be a nice area to put them in. Now this is a perfect example of what we mean by moving things that perhaps have outgrown the space that they're in. This is an absolutely lovely mock orange. It smells heavenly. I mean, just standing here, I can smell it now. But it is crowding out the Bosnian pine, which is a very slow growing pine tree that will take forever to get tall. And with this monk's hood, which needs to be kind of contained, our poor hydrangea under here is getting no help at all.
And I don't even remember what we planted here.
No, this was something I think we got it from Dorothy, perhaps, and we're not sure what it was from her.
Oh, okay.
But it's there. So we're going to be moving the mock orange for sure, probably the hydrangea, and we're going to be corralling this.
We have to put that in a cage.
Yes.
So we can kind of control it.
It's probably too big now for a cage, but we will be binding it up a little bit.
Well, in spring we'll have to put one, because if you look in the inside, it's already kind of flopping because of the weight.
Right. So I'll take twine and put a circle around it so it stays put for now. Another area we're going to be addressing is this front area, and I'm going to start with these Montauk daisies. These, if I cut them in half now, they will be much fuller and not flop over like they may have a tendency to do. Something you can also do with the sedum, the Autumn Joy sedum. Now is a perfect time to just kind of cut it in half. It'll bloom later, but it'll be sturdier and it'll last longer. So this will be cut back. The Husker Red is fine, it's in its cage. The Coral Bells are fine. But then if you move over here, these Bleeding Hearts are done now. And they are putting seeds everywhere. Each flower created all of these seeds in here. And as you can see, they're popping up everywhere.
Well, here's a baby over here.
Yep.
It started from a seed, probably from last year.
Possibly, yes. So what I'm going to do here, what I do every year, and it doesn't seem to bother them, is I will chop them down almost by half, these, and there'll still be enough greenery in there to give the roots nutrition, but it'll kind of clean this up and it'll prevent all those seeds from sprouting. And then the same thing here. Now at this time of year, it's getting to the point where our hostas, which decided they were okay in the sun, need some trimming because they get sunburned. And that's fine, because inside here are all sorts of new leaves that are just waiting to come out and look beautiful again. So even those perennials, we'll chop back a little bit. Birdbath needs some washing. That was my gift for Mother's Day. Still looking beautiful. Again, another hosta. This is our Miss Kim lilac bush that needs trimming. Now that it's done blooming, it's a perfect time to trim. For anything that bloomed this spring, once it's done, you can trim it. So this will be trimmed down. Not too much, but just so it looks orderly again. Again, more and more.
Well, you can see why it's time to cut down.
Right. This is how they'd all start looking. And that just looks ugly. And there, we know there's other things under there that we would like to see. And look at all of these babies.
Well, if you're in the neighborhood and you'd like to have a bleeding heart, a giant bleeding heart, you know where you can come and do some digging and some transplanting, and
exactly.
They are amazing, though.
They're perfect. I mean, they're a perfect spring flower. They tend to like a little bit of shade, but as you can see, these guys don't get shade. But it's early in the year when they come out, so they'll be fine pretty much everywhere you put them. This is also the time of year where I try to get my daffodils under control. Now, they were lovely this spring, absolutely gorgeous. They lasted a really long time, but now it's time for them to just rejuvenate themselves by being in the sun. And at the same time, they're kind of in the way of everything else that's coming up around them. So what I like to do is just take a bunch, pull off a long one. Okay, and then you can either braid them like this one is, or just put them in a grouping like that. I like to braid, so if I have time, I'll braid some of them.
You could have your own leaf salon.
Bring your leaves here.
Too bad my hair is too short, otherwise I'd have you braid it.
Did we do that already?
Yeah, I know. Ginger came over here one day, and while I'm trying to work, she decided she was going to braid my hair.
And she did.
Yeah. I must admit, I didn't like the way I looked.
There we go. Now that still gives them enough sun that can go down and refresh the roots, but it'll still give me a chance to see some of the flowers. Now, when they turn totally yellow and they're really totally done, then I'll just cut the whole thing off. If you haven't had a chance to take off some of the buds, then this is a time to do that. Now, this is one of our climbing vines.
That not you the grew from seed, right?
Right, not the perennial ones, but these are just morning glories and
annual.
Something else over here. I'm not quite sure what that is. Could be sunflowers from the birds. But anyway, I'm training it to climb up this pole. I'm helping it out a little bit with some sticks, but I think it'll catch on and soon it'll be up there. This is our little glowing light that's still glowing even though it's not Christmas anymore.
Ho, ho, ho.
Now here's an example of what the bleeding hearts will look like after I trim them. So there's still plenty of green to help the roots, but now they're out of my way. And I dug up some of the babies, so they're gone. And in here now I have caladium and an elephant ear that like to shade. So that'll be pretty there. Waiting for the poppies to get done. They're kind of sprawling all over the place. But they're so unique, I kind of hate to get rid of them. But they'll kind of lop over too.
Well, this is quite a difference in here. I remember we couldn't even walk through this path. We couldn't even see the pathway.
This bleeding heart was up to here. And I trimmed it back. Now I see I missed this tree. Somehow there's a tree growing in here. I'll have to get that one out of there. But this is plenty. This is how much I trim it back every year. And it doesn't seem to bother it at all. And then in here, I just cleaned it all up. Planted some annuals just to give it some color. There's a liatris. This is what a liatris will turn into. If you want to see a liatris that is just starting, I have some of those. They're right here. They look like grass coming up. But they're very straight. And if you pull them out, so I'll get this one. There's pink at the bottom, and there'll be a little teeny tiny little bulb underneath there. So if you're growing liatris from seed, that's what you look for. That's what it'll turn out to.
Well, you also put some nasturtiums I see in here.
Right.
What was in the center that is just
in the center
to come
is a begonia.
Oh, yeah, okay.
And then these are asparagus fern. Yeah. That I took in last fall and kept all winter, and now it's back out.
Well, here's an area I know you were working on earlier today.
Right. Well, this is an area where every year it gets what I think is wild goldenrod. I don't like it. It takes over. There are all sorts of roots underneath here, big white roots that even though I've pulled them out, the roots are still there. I have my allium bulbs in here. There are some daffodils in here. Right there is black-eyed Susan. There is a poppy. There are two. Well, maybe not. There's this one hibiscus here.
That's the red one, I believe. Yep.
And
plus your Japanese fern. This is the one that had the double blooms.
Right. So I've trimmed this off now. I left 3 seed pods. So I'll harvest those just in case I decide I wanted to try some from seed. And these are daylilies.
Yeah. And
they're
you
yellow.
Have the aren't those the stargazers that
these
are?
These are the stargazer lilies that are just prolific this year.
I'm glad we put that cage there.
Yes. This one didn't quite make it in, but that's okay. And right behind it is a terrible thistle.
Oh my goodness. How did that get in there?
You tell me.
I missed it. Well, I know what I'll be doing this afternoon.
Uh-huh.
So what are you going to do with this area now that it's barren?
Well, we talked about maybe digging the whole thing up and starting over again.
So reshaping the garden again.
Reshaping, exactly.
The never-ending story.
That's what makes it fun. That's how your garden evolves. And if you have the time to do it, fine. If you don't feel guilty about it, because it'll just be there waiting for you sooner or later when you get the chance.
Is that why you hire me out to all your viewers? No wonder I have a sore back.
No, I just keep you for me.
Oh, okay.
I need you.
Yeah. Well, it's going to look beautiful, especially here you have a whole bunch of more daisies, or not daisies.
These are lilies.
Lilies.
I believe they're yellow. And when I planted them here, they were probably this tall.
Yeah, I remember. You could barely see them.
I had some over there.
And look what's growing in here.
Yes. Now, unfortunately, these are not eating strawberries.
Are you sure?
Yes. I'm very sure because I was digging them out of the gravel. They are just ornamental.
Well, that's too bad.
I know. No. I was going to move some over to the other patch, but when I saw they were very tiny and the fruit itself is very, very tiny, then I knew.
Well, you need to get into the strawberry patch and start picking. My goodness.
Exactly.
Well, I know you've got the ladder set up back there for me because you're going to be hanging some.
I'm going to be hanging some big orange and white globes that Rick got me from IKEA. We have 2 in the front that are just darling. Every time I see them, I think it's the full moon.
So they're solar globes.
They are. And they stay lit all the way through the entire night, at least for the summer they do. Now we're thinking we're going to hang some off of the ginkgo tree. And then I can peek out the window and see them at night.
Mm-hmm.
Or they're going to keep us awake all night.
Yeah. We'll see. Well, let's get to work.
This is an area that we started before by taking out one of the other giant fleece plants. As you can see what the fleece plant did to our
arborvitaes. Yeah.
Okay. There are just a few things in here. There's a couple of iris and there's some lilies back there that are so-so. And then there's all of this, which again, I think this is goldenrod. And when I pull it up, it's going to be roots that I don't want in here. So.
Is it the good goldenrod?
No, this is the bad goldenrod.
The bad goldenrod.
And I don't know how it got here. Again, comes in on things, the seeds from the birds dropping, who knows.
Can you pull those out or do they have to be dug out?
I think they're going to have to be dug out because.
Are they deep?
They break off nicely, and you think you have some of the root, but it's not.
Okay. Well, I'll get the shovel and work in this area as well. You want to get going on the globes here so we can start hanging those while the ladder is here?
Yes, and then they can be charging up for tonight.
Okay. Well, go get a couple of globes. I'm going to go make a couple of hangers for them and loop them around the branch so we don't strangle the branch.
Meet you back here.
Okay.
Here are the giant solar balls. They're gorgeous. And this is the solar panel that will light this tiny little LED light. And that's the on-off switch.
And the batteries are already included?
Batteries inside.
Are they rechargeable, do you know?
I don't remember. I'd have to
possibly
read the paper again.
Yeah.
Possibly.
Yeah, and these are from IKEA, right?
Right. And they're supposed to last for a year.
Mm-hmm.
At least a year.
They're waterproof.
And they're waterproof, yep. Stay out all kinds of weather. what Rick has done now so that we're not strangling the branches of the tree when we hang them. He took this rubber coated wire.
It's aluminum wire.
It's aluminum wire. And he's made three different options to put around the tree. Now this would go, that my arm is the tree branch. So this would go in over the tree branch, and then he took these two circles, loops, and twisted them together here so that they're one, and then this will go right through here and hang up like this. Or another option would be to bend the wire this way. This again goes over the branch. Then you can take this loop that he's created and this hook that he's created and put it that way, and then the lantern would hang from here.
Well, before I do that, once I get it over, I take this and just bend it over, keep it looped.
But what we're trying to avoid is harming the tree in any way.
Well, you don't want to bind it or strangle anything.
Right. Yep. And these just bop around in the wind. It doesn't seem to bother them. They've been up now for months out in the front, and they're reliable. They turn on every night.
So let's go hang them up.
As if the ginkgo tree wasn't unique enough, now it has two giant solar lanterns hanging from it. It'll be great to see it tonight. Ooh, I can hardly wait. We just wanted to let you know how the lanterns looked at nighttime. I think I really like them.
And they're not fully charged yet either.
No. Well, if they charge up for between 6 to 12 hours, they will stay on for 12 hours. So these didn't have anywhere near that time.
Really cool.
They come in all different sizes too, right?
Yeah. So, there you go.
Thank you, honey.
You're welcome.
Well, we're calling it quits for today. We trimmed the lilac bush. Looks very nice now. Could almost play basketball with it. Took out some of the bleeding hearts that were in here. Still have a little more to do. Oh, let's see, what else do we do? Oh, you took out the rose bushes. Oh, and they are vicious.
Well, let's go over to the trailer. And I think.
And you're not even all cut up. I don't believe it. And don't forget your tree behind you.
Oh, yeah.
That was a major one. There were some limbs on there that just looked like they were going to be too fragile and come down and hit the car or whatever. So I helped with two limbs, and when I got back from wherever I was, there were three or four extra ones cut down, even though I said, don't do this while I'm not here.
Actually, I was going to cut the whole tree down.
With that little saw?
No, I'd have to bring out the chainsaw for that.
Oh, I'm glad you didn't.
Well, let's go over to the trailer.
Let's see what you filled it up with. This is what those vicious rose bushes look like. These little guys are so sharp and deadly. It's just amazing. I don't see any scratches on you. And the bigger the limb, of course, the bigger the thorn that goes with it. So we have the whole trailer. Well, it's not quite full yet, but it's got a lot of willow branches in it, a lot of bleeding hearts. Obviously, the rose bushes are in here.
And, yes, they are.
And the fleece plant that we started.
Yes, the giant fleece plant.
Yes. So we are going to stop for today.
We are?
Yes, we are. And take a shower.
Is that what you're recommending?
I am. Yes. Hit the shower. Maybe even a sprecher.
Ooh.
Who knows?
That might be an incentive to take a shower.
There you go. You'll feel better. If you enjoyed this video, please give us a thumbs up. And we truly appreciate you watching. And thank you for your comments and your tips and your questions. Just makes us think more and practice some other things that we hadn't even thought about. So thank you again for watching, and if you'd like to become part of our garden family, there is a tiny little red button somewhere over here, and if you just subscribe there, you can be part of our family. Thank you again. Bye for now.
Sprickers, huh? Okay, well, that's enough motivation for me. I think Scott and Sarah know what I'm talking about, right?
Of course they do. And your daughter.
That's right.
Connect with us on YouTube.